Well, I mean, another year, but is this one different? I mean, Coach was just talking about all the hype you've been getting. Is this off-season been different? Is this season different for you?
I mean, the off-season definitely looked a little bit different, just kind of trying to focus on ways to honestly drown out some of the hype noise, whatever you want to call it. So that was a little bit different. And then obviously just trying to come back healthy from the hamstring injury that I had in the summer. So that was a lot of rehab and stuff like that. And then honestly just trying to find some ways to improve physically, mentally, working. Got like a sleep study, trying to get the sleep figured out, just trying to find ways to get better. The season, I don't think it's honestly too different besides the fact that for me it's Coach Mays' last year, so I know the guys really want to give him a good send-off. You know, we know it's an important year. We have the squad to do something cool, so we've been working really hard to do that. But for me, it looks pretty much the same. We're just trying to compete and win some games.
What was the USA baseball experience like, and did you play any other off-season baseball after that, or?
Yeah, so I started off at the Cape playing for the Chatham Anglers, which was really fun, and then I went to USA. The USA was a pretty crazy experience, just kind of with the level of competition that was there. Obviously playing with, you know, some teammates that pretty much everybody knows, like, you know, Jack Caglione from Florida. Some of those guys, too, were just incredible to meet. And then obviously playing like Team Japan and Chinese Taipei. It's pretty cool. The Chinese Taipei ranged anywhere from like 18 to 35. Some of them had wives and kids. The Japanese were more our age, so they were college kids that were kind of draft eligible. So we got to face like the number one prospect in Japan who was going to get drafted that year, which is really cool. So it was just a really great experience on both ends.
From an eyeball standpoint, obviously a lot of scouts and stuff there at the USA stuff. How does that prepare you for this year when you know every field you're going to go to this year, there's going to be a lot of scouts there for you?
Yeah, for sure. It was great preparation. I think it was really cool. I honestly didn't even realize how many were there until I would see videos of like highlights that people would post later. And you could look in the stands and there's just like hundreds. And it's like, wow. So, yeah, it's great preparation. Learning how to play in front of those guys is it can be something. I mean, at the end of the day, you kind of just have to play like they're not there because inherently they don't really matter. And you kind of just got to worry about winning games for your team. But it is good practice because, you know, if you look into the stands and you see a bunch of cameras videoing you and people like that that you know are judging and watching your every move, it can kind of get to you a little bit. So having that practice was definitely good and set me up well for the season.
Going to an off-season after hitting 446 and say, I'm going to try to improve?
Yeah, so I think the biggest thing is obviously, like, the stats area could be hard to improve on, but there's other areas that you can get better in. So for me, it's obviously, like I said, physically, mentally, just finding ways to get better. So trying to stay healthier in all aspects, working on a little bit better mechanics, things like that, just stuff that makes me feel like I am a better player. And you never know, maybe the results don't replicate exactly how it went last year. But to me, I was kind of just having this conversation today. It was like, I feel like I got better throughout the summer and the fall. So I'm definitely excited, looking forward to it. But yeah, just focusing on the process of trying to find a little bit ways to get better, whatever it may be.
What is your hitting philosophy when you go up there?
It kind of depends on the pitcher, but for me, it's pretty simple. I'm just trying to hit like a line drive at the shortstop's head. For me, it helps me keep inside of the ball, not trying to do too much, and just keep my direction.
Pull for more power this offseason to get there?
I mean, definitely dabbled with it to try to work on it a little bit, but still for me, I want to stick to my main approach. So kind of working on the skill of pulling the ball for power, but my approach is still kind of consistent.
So at some point, Coach Mazey comes up to you and says, hey, JJ, we're going to need you to play shortstop this year. Kind of take me, you know, what were your thoughts on it? I know you played it some in high school, but, you know, that was a few years ago. You know, how's that transition been working out for you?
Yeah, I think for me, I saw it as a challenge and an opportunity. You know, shortstops, people think it's one of the hardest positions to play, and so every team needs a good shortstop, and for me, it's opportunity to help my team win. So Coach Mays kind of explained it to me in our entry meeting, like, hey, we don't really know what the team's going to look like, but need you to get reps at short and be ready to play there. And that's kind of all I needed to try to work on that and try to better myself. If that's a spot that we have open that needs filled, I'm gladly going to do it, and I try very hard to do my best. So it's been something we've been working with our new infield coach, Coach Racinger. So that's been a lot of fun. It's just transitioning and yeah, kind of thinking back to my high school days when I played there.
Played third, second, short. If Hussey gets injured, I mean, could play first, maybe catcher? I mean,
first might be a little bit sketchy. I would say after those three infield positions, probably somewhere in the outfield.
But still trying to pitch at some point? I know you
they won't. Yeah, they won't let me. Like, yeah. I mean, I think I don't know what I'd have to do to let them do do that, let me do that. It'd be a lot. So that's still a dream of mine for sure.
During the offseason, was there ever a thought in your mind of possibly leaving and entering the transfer portal?
No.
Why?
There's no reason. I mean, I came here to play baseball and to give myself opportunity to play close to home with people who took a chance on me. And I'm good to people who have been good to me, and the coaching staff and the people here have been nothing but amazing to me, and they gave me exactly what I wanted, so there's no reason to leave.
I can't imagine that stopped other schools from calling, maybe mom calling mom, dad, or...
No, none of that, really, honestly. It was pretty cool. I think they probably knew that I wasn't going anywhere, so it was good.
The difference from your freshman year to your sophomore year, was that just maturity, or did something click? What turns you into, the best player in college baseball from there?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a lot. I mean, maturity is a big one. Experience, stuff like that, finding ways to get better, more confidence, working on mechanics, whatever it is. I'm obviously a very big faith-driven person, so I got closer to God, my relationship with that, which was huge for me, and just let me kind of take pressure off of myself and focus on playing for him instead of other people. So that was a big area that I probably don't talk about enough. But, I mean, there's a lot of different things. I think it's really just growth and maturity as a person. And yeah, that's pretty much it.
Is it hard to accept what you've become? I mean, not accept, but believe what you've become?
I mean, it's what I've become. I mean, there's a lot I have to do. I think I'm still just a college baseball player for me. So I try not to really think about too much of what I've done or who I am, because it's not really important. It's kind of just got to find ways to get better and play the game. And, obviously I have aspirations to play professional baseball, and I've wanted to do that as a kid. So I'm a long way from that, and I got a lot to get better at.
Do you think can teams pitch around you when you're hitting leadoff?
I mean, I don't know if I'm hitting leadoff or where I'm hitting, so I don't know. Can teams pitch around me? Yeah, I guess they can try to. But, I mean, then again, they probably don't want to walk me because I'm a threat to steal bases, and I can end up on second and hit scores me. They can obviously find ways to try to maybe point out somewhere that I'm struggling with this pitch and stuff like that and try to really hammer that. But, I mean, it's college baseball, so it's kind of hard for pitchers to be perfect and stuff like that. So, I mean, at the end of the day, they're going to have to throw me strikes, and I'll be able to hit it.
What a team, how they decide to approach you is up to them. It's not up to you. But is that a worry at all, that teams aren't going to give you an opportunity to hit, to swing at good pitches, to showcase, your talents?
For me, it'll be a cool learning standpoint. I think it's a big thing is if teams are kind of hesitant to give me stuff to hit, I just got to be patient and take the walks. And, I mean, obviously, yeah, I'm up there to do damage and hit, and that's growth for me as a hitter to be able to be more patient and take a walk. Because that's going to help the team at the end of the day. And if they're not throwing me strikes and they're walking me, I'll get on base. They're going to have to throw the next guy strikes. And I think we have the lineup to do some serious damage if it turns into that.
If you were a pitcher, would you pitch to yourself if you didn't have to?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, it's still baseball. So, I mean, it's hard. Like, we got to hit stuff that's moving fast and moving a bunch, and you don't know what's coming. And so it's hard. I mean, I'm confident in my hitting abilities, but at the end of the day, I mean, the best way to get me out is probably to just attack me with confidence. I mean, I'm in there with confidence. And you got to pitch to me with confidence and let the better man win.
What's the team like around you? Some new faces, some returning faces. So what's this team going to be like?
Really good chemistry. I think it's cool. It's a balance. We have more new guys than returners, which is kind of starting to become the trend. But we've done a really good job of finding ways to connect outside of the field together, building really good bonds. I mean, this is probably one of the most selfless teams I've been on. In my career, everybody's rooting for each other. There's nobody who's a bad apple. It's just a bunch of guys coming together to find ways to get better. And I think the coolest thing, too, is just having a conversation with some of the guys is, people may know that they might not have a huge role this year, but they're super excited for the two innings that they might get to pitch or the couple at-bats they might get to have. And there's not a lot of, man, I hope my teammate does bad so I get the chance. It's like we want everyone to do good, and if that opportunity comes, they're ready to go about it.
How's the new turf? How does it play? Is it different from the old stuff?
Yeah, it's a lot different. It's slower. It's honestly been pretty bouncy. It's like they say that the time frame for it to be in its best spot is like in a year and a half or so like that. So I won't get to experience it, unfortunately. But it's in a phase where it almost gets like better every day just because it's kind of settling in and breaking in. And so it's been a little bit of a tough adjustment, I won't lie, obviously just because of how kind of – fast our turf used to play. So it's a little bit slower. The ball bounces a little bit higher. Our last turf was kind of skippier. But we've been trying to hammer away ground balls and just try to replicate some in-game hops and see what will happen. It's been a little bit of a learning curve, but I think we should be all right.
You guys last year as a program got a pretty good taste of success with the conference championship, getting to the NCAAs. But obviously there was still some disappointment with how the year finished. So what's the next step, I guess? And can this team take that next step?
For sure, yeah. I mean, the next step is just getting to a super, I guess. I mean, obviously we're full force ahead on Stetson. That's really the only thing we're concerned about. Because I think that's what hurt us last year is we were looking forward too much and we didn't see the Longhorns in front of us who would kind of, sweep us and take us down a bad path. So that's the biggest thing is kind of just staying consistent with the theme of we have to focus on the game that we're about to play. We have to focus on the team that we're about to play and we can't look too far ahead or get too satisfied. I think last year was a big thing is winning became a habit. We obviously expected to win every game just by the way that we were playing. And we kind of took it for granted. Like I said, we went down to Texas. It was like, oh, we just win one game. We're conference champions. We're hosting a regional. We can go to a super. Let's go to Omaha, blah, 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 blah. Just thinking way too far ahead, and it got too much for us. So that's a big area where the guys that are returners know what that feels like. I know what that feels like, so I can kind of help some of the guys if we get into that situation again where it's like, hey, man, like, don't matter who we play. We could be playing the last team in conference in the last week. They can beat us, so we got to focus on them. And that's the next step for us is just to finish strong, which we have the capability to do so. So I'm definitely excited for that.
The way it all ended, did it become a motivating factor at all, in the offseason heading into this year?
For sure, yeah. I mean, nobody wants to end the year 1-7, especially after winning so many games how we did. So it's tough. We don't want to experience that again. So like I said, we've been trying to make sure we focus on just not looking too far ahead. And so, yeah, it's a big motivator to kind of go out that way, and we want to make sure that doesn't happen again.
One more about the shortstop. I mean, for years you had Tuck over there, and obviously the contributions he made. So you're kind of taking that spot now. So how do you break in a new second baseman and develop a kind of relationship that you and Tuck had?
Yeah, I mean, it's tough. I mean, Tuck was my man. He's taught me everything, the ropes of the program, how to play, how to be a better person, how to be a better leader, everything. I learned so much from him, and I give so much credit to him. And thankfully for me, the good part about that is, like, I know how he operates, and he operates the right way, and he's taught me that, so I can teach others that. That's the biggest thing is, like, honestly, when I try to lead people, I just try to think back to how he kind of coached me and what he did for me. So I don't know who's going to be up the middle with me, but whoever it is, I know we're going to have a great relationship and we're going to make a bunch of plays. So it's tough to replace Tuck. I don't really think you can replace Tuck, in my opinion. But I'll do my best to kind of just transfer on what he taught me, and hopefully that'll just continue down the line.
We asked Randy who can make a jump kind of similar to what you did last year from one year to the next. He pointed out Logan Sauve. Do you see that from him, or is there someone else you see kind of making that jump?
Yeah, I think there's a couple people, and Logan is definitely one of them. I think he's had a ridiculous fall. He was pretty much neck and neck with me in, like, every category hitting-wise during the fall, which is amazing to see. It really did remind me of kind of what happened to me last year in the fall. So that was great to see. He's gotten better offensively, defensively, and just became calmer. So I'm super excited to see how he does. I think he's going to have a great year. Igar Ellis Garcia, obviously same type of guy who should have another great year. I mean, he's just gotten better and better and better. And he's trusting the process, so he's one too. I think Sam White's gotten a ton better. Really just that entire sophomore class. There's so many people who look really good. Carson Estridge from the mound who looks really good. Gavin Van Kempen's been working on a different arm slot, which has been coming out really nice. So I think there's a bunch of guys in that class who have a chance to really improve. We have Skylar King who's been playing probably the best ball with us that he's ever played. So it's looking really good and really promising from them. Really just all of those guys have a chance to kind of make a big jump, and I'm looking forward to it.
You mentioned that Logan had a really good fall. Obviously, you had a good fall last year, or heading into last year. You experienced that firsthand, so you kind of probably knew the moment it clicked for you and things just changed. Did you see the moment or moments where it really just changed over for Logan?
Yeah, I mean, he just started barreling up more balls. It was more contact, less strikeouts, and it was loud contact. I think that was something for him last year is, I mean, he would barrel the ball every once in a while, but I think he had some weak contact here and there, and, like, in the fall, it was just missile after missile, and his exit velos were up, his average exit velo was up, everything. He was just pounding the ball, which was really great to see. So I'm sure he noticed it, And kind of honestly, when you're in that train, it's like you're just playing well. You've played well before, so you probably don't think too much of it. But all the guys around him were definitely like, wow, like he is smoking the ball. So it was great.
Like last year, like Traxel and Ben pitched a lot of innings. Mm-hmm. But they weren't, they weren't 95, right. 96 kind of guys. And the offense kind of carried, was the headlines last year. How do you see that working out? Because, I'm thinking of guys like, you said Van Kempen, Porco, Aiden. These are guys who can bring it, mm-hmm. 95. So does this become more of a pitching team this year than last year? Or can it be as offensively driven as it was? The aspects of the team, the breakdown of the team.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's similar. I think we do have a little bit more, like, the power arms that are looking like they're going to be starters. We're going to have some more velo. And you never know how that works. I mean, obviously, Traxel and them did an unbelievable job last year, and they did everything we needed them to do. And, yeah, of course, they didn't have the velo, so we have some of that this year, which it's a cool shift for sure. You think it'll maybe be a more dominant performance pitching staff starting-wise, or more strikeouts, stuff like that. You don't know, but, I mean, yeah, looking back on those guys last year was great, what they did for us. So I think this year we have a chance to just be really well-balanced on both sides of the ball, like literally everything. I think we have a chance to hit for a lot of power, good average. We should be able to steal some bases. And then the pitching, too. The pitching's been looking really good. We've got a lot of good arms. So, I think overall it's just going to be really well balanced. And we'll really see how it plays out. We might be more offensive, more pitching. Maybe our defense shines, whatever it may be. But it's looking like we'll be pretty well-rounded.
Obviously, you and Grant came in here together as freshmen. And his power numbers have always been there.
Right.
Randy was saying that he's kind of cutting down on the strikeouts. He's become a little bit different of a hitter this year.
Yep.
Do you see that? And how different is he now? As you've been here 3 years with him now.
For sure. No, this is the best he's ever looked. And it's pretty evident. Strikeouts are obviously something that's going to happen, and you can't go to the plate, hoping that you don't strike out. You kind of just have to want to get a hit and barrel the ball well. But it's something that he's noticed. He's like, I strike out too much, and I've heard it too much. Like, I want to get rid of this. And so he's definitely put more emphasis on making sure he makes contact, developing a better two-strike approach, kind of just cutting down on the big swings with two strikes, and, still trying to do damage, but hoping that he can put the barrel to the wall. So his contact rate has gone up, which inherently makes him a better hitter because he hits the ball hard when he hits it. So if he's hitting the ball, it's probably going far, and it's probably hit pretty hard. So it's been great to see, and he looks really, really good.
You mentioned how you guys have kind of had a sense that you want to send Coach Mazie off well. What's he meant to you as a coach, and what kind of are you guys, on the inside thinking about as trying to do something big for him in his last season?
Yeah, I mean, Coach Mazie has just been pretty much everything you could dream of at a head coach position. He's been like another father to me, and taught me so much stuff. He just recently dropped off 2 pounds of venison meat in my locker that I was able to try, which was great. He's like that. You can have a funny conversation that has nothing to do with baseball. You can have a conversation that has everything to do with baseball, and it's just a great balance. So he means a lot to me. He's just been a great mentor, and he was a big reason why I came here, and it's been everything that I've hoped for. We just hope to have a good year. Obviously, we don't want to get too far ahead of ourselves, but we want to come out swinging against Stetson, play well, and hopefully carry that into more and more wins. So, we don't want, obviously, to get too big-headed and, we're going to Omaha right off the bat, send Coach Mazie home the right way. Obviously, yeah, do we want that? For sure, but we got to focus, obviously, on Stetson and those games that are coming right up. So that's our main focus right now, and just trying to win those.
Kind of a weird question. I apologize ahead of time for it, but you've already talked about what it's going to be like playing in front of the scouts, and that stuff's going to be there every game. The other day the press release came out about how there's a big increase in ticket sales, season ticket sales for baseball. How much credit do you take for that? And do you even think about that kind of stuff? I mean, the way this program has really kind of jumped since you've been here. I mean, some of that credit has to go to you. I wonder if that's something that is on your radar.
Yeah, it's definitely not something I think about. I think it's a direct reflection on the team as a whole. Obviously, winning a bunch of games. If I was having the success I have and we won 10 games, I don't think a lot of people would be coming. So I think it just has to do with the team as a whole. It starts with the coaching staff. And, yeah, I mean, when the coaching staff prepares us the right way and we have multiple players who are playing at a high level and the team's doing well, I think it's something the fans will get behind. So I think that's where the credit goes for sure.
Will you cook the venison yourself?
I did, yeah. I threw it on the grill. But Coach Mazey had it prepped. Like, he vacuum sealed it, already had his seasonings in there. So all I had to do was cut it open and throw it on the stove and then eat it. And it was great. I mean, I can cook stuff when I need to. Obviously, our schedules are so busy that I don't really like to go home after like a six-hour day and cook up anything too crazy. But if I need to, I could do it.
You had venison before?
I had jerky. I'd never had, like, he called it venison burger, so I'd never had it like that before. And? It was great. Uh-huh. Yeah, I think I ate like a pound and a half of it. Cool.
If you go back to this point last year, like, you know, the all Big 12 stuff came out and your name wasn't on it. And now you're the preseason, you know, unanimous player and, you know, projected to go this, that, you know, in the draft. Has it happened fast when you kind of take it in those terms?
I mean, yeah. I mean, I guess you could say that. I think, yes, that was something last year. Like, I have my lock screen as the preseason list last year because I wasn't on it. And that was kind of a motivator for me. And now that I'm on it, nothing changes for me. I think I've had this conversation before. That's a big example. It's like those guys didn't believe in me until they had no choice but to believe in me, right? So you can't let them kind of dictate how you feel. It doesn't matter if they're putting me number one here and there and there and there. If I don't have a good year, I'm not going to be on those lists anymore. So to me, it doesn't matter. I just want to play well for the team. And if I do so and focus on that, the other stuff should take care of it.
Find something to motivate, right?
I mean, yeah, have to, for sure.
Pretzel necklace back this year?
I don't know. That's kind of like a bench thing where if we got pretzels that day and they can craft it up, they'll do it. I know we have something that we'll use, but I don't know. Maybe the pretzel necklace will be back.
You guys are still kind of confined. Like, props have to stay in the dugout still, right?
Yeah, or else you get suspended.
Crazy. Like tracks.
Exactly. Yeah. Cones and stuff.